Dream Team in hand. Of numerous universities, including Boise State, Webster, and Capella. Okay. Over here we have Dr. Jane Arrington, prior ISPI president and a member of the board of directors for ISPI. Jeannie is
calling there.
Okay. No problem. Jeannie is president of the J. Farrington Group, her consulting firm, which works with both large and small organizations across many different industries, including the DoD, commercial industry, high tech, and some commercial enterprises. She's also a published author, and I'm sure you've read many of her articles as well. And for those of you who don't know me, I am Claire Carey, a prior ISPI president and board of director for many years. And I am director of the Education and Training Directorate for the Texas Cryptologic Center in San Antonio, Texas, which is with the Department of Defense. So what you have here as part of your presentation team is best of both worlds. You have external consultants, you have an internal performance practitioner, you have academics, you have manager, so you have a combination of skills and talents and basically just three really crazy, wacky women who are here to have fun with you today. So let me ask you, why are you here, real quick? How about you? Why did you come here to MythBusters?
I was at 5U Research Evidence-Based, and so I was interested in
Research Evidence-Based. Back here, why are you here?
Because of three crazy wacky women.
You got it! It's good to have you here. Okay, over here, why are you here? I thought maybe you heard the guy is giving away a Mercedes at the end of today's session. Well, that too. Okay, your choice. We hope you're here to have some fun with looking at what is research and what is not research-based, and how we can apply some of those tools to our own workplace. In the true spirit of ISPI, we're going to review the objectives as we presented them to you. So we are going to look at the criteria for assessing performance improvement strategies. We're going to be examining workplace practices, many of which you have all encountered in your work lives. And some are the practices that are commonly believed to be effective and relevant and research-based, and some will be, and some won't be. We'll also be offering to you an ingenious, brilliant, very creative framework that helps you put both how we learn and what we know and put that together, so you will actually have an additional tool in your toolkit when you're having to make decisions in your own workplace as to whether you should adopt a particular intervention or not. And then at last, we're going to have some fun with you sharing some of your challenges and issues in your workplace and how you might use this. But wait, there's more. For those of you who would like to have more detail and more information with the citations of specific research, we have extra handouts for you at the end of the session, and you're welcome to come forward at the end, all right? So that's your extra gift, along with the Lexus and Mercedes that Guy will be raffling off. So without further ado, Mary, let me turn it over to you to get us started.
Thank you, Claire. Welcome, welcome, everybody. So what's the big deal here? How many of you are practitioners, consider yourself practitioners? Yeah? Any students? We have some students. How about researchers? Anybody done research? Okay, well, we have lots of different hats in here. We also have a lot in common. Whether you're a practitioner, researcher, a veteran, a novice, regardless of specialty, we all have an obligation to engage in valid and reliable practice, and at the very least, not to kill our clients. Well, this is a really tall order. How do we distinguish fact from folklore, science from serendipity, sense from nonsense, or just plain things that work from stuffage that doesn't? Well, we're going to give you some essential tools of evidence so you too can be an HPT MythBuster. Let's consider first some fundamentals, and this is in the second page of your handout, if you'd like to follow along here. What are evidence-based practices? I'm sure you've heard the term, and I'm just going to quickly go over some fundamentals just to make sure that we're on the same page, because so you'll all be on the same page with my definition, that is. And so evidence-based practices are reliable. That means they're consistent. They consistently produce the results that you expect. They're valid. That means they're meaningful. They do what they say they're going to do. They're enduring. They will last after you go home and are no longer there on site consulting and pointing the way to what should be done. And finally, as I mentioned earlier, they're safe. They're not going to kill your client. What is evidence? When you think about the word evidence, what comes to mind? Word association. What comes to mind when you think about the word evidence? Anybody?
Research data.
Research data.
What else?
CSI. Very good. Any other words about evidence?
Proof.
I do think of the legal system. Law.
Law.
Data.
From outside.
Outside. Okay, hold on to that one. Yeah. Any? Yes? Okay. All right. Now.
Could you say that louder, please?
It's observable by a third party.
Thank you.
Very good. Now, as Jim mentioned, he came to mind the law. Unfortunately, or fortunately, we don't have rules of evidence. However, we do have some ways to distinguish evidence. Publicly observable. Objectively demonstrable. Another word that's associated with this is empirical. Now, the stuffy textbook definitions are in your handout, so we're just going to refer to that if you want the citations. So, I think we have a good form, a good basis for the evidence. Okay, let's think about another word that came. We said evidence is also empirical. Again, let's do a word association. What comes to mind when you think of the word empirical?
Academic,
okay.
Observable.
Tangible.
I'm sorry?
Experience.
What else? Well, that's pretty cool, because it matches the textbook definitions. It matches what my understanding of empirical is, that, and it shares meaning with evidence. It's known through the senses. It's observable. It's tangible. Others can see it, touch it, feel it. Bottom line, a good litmus test for empirical is that it's countable. I also heard the word data and quantity or quantitative. Just as to keep us all together on this, something doesn't have to be a quantity to be empirical. For example, people. People are a quantity or a quality?
Depends a person.
Yes.
A person is a quantity or a quality? It's a quality, yeah. Height is a quantity. But the litmus test here is we can count the number of people in the room. I could count it, Hillary could count it, Jim could count it, and hopefully we could all come up with the same count. Publicly observable and verifiable. So we've got a good little foundation here to go on for some key concepts of empirical and evidence. So we sorted out the evidence essentials. Now let's move on to consider how we evaluate or consider the evidence. Now keep in mind, I heard the word data and quantity, but keep in mind, the numbers don't make the decision. People make the decision. The data do not speak for themselves. We have to interpret the data. We then have to make decisions about the data. And I'd like to share with you a couple of tips for evaluating the data. One is thinking about how did you know? Another one is consider the source. And thirdly, I'm going to challenge you with go forth and question authority. The ways of knowing, I'm taking great license with a late 18th century philosopher, Charles Sanders Peirce, who gave us a way to look at the ways of knowing. How did we come to know things? One way he described was tenacity. We do it that way because we've always done it that way. Tradition, for example. Granddad always carves at Thanksgiving. Everybody else could probably carve, but Granddad always does it. Another basis of how we might decide things or how we might, what might influence our decision is authority. Experts or someone we respect told us to do that. I don't know about you, I was playing out in the yard when I was young and Mom says, don't run out in the street. And I say, why? And she says, because I told you to. So medical authority is directive. The why is often not there with it. We all have our authority figures. We have our mentors. We have our major professors. We have our gurus. We have credible sources. And we often base our decision on their direction and guidance. We may reason something out, inductively or deductively. We may also use the method of empiricism. Count things, measure things, test things, and correct things. This method is therefore fallible. It's subject to testing, it's subject to verifying, and it's subject to comparing what you came up with. Now, these ways of knowing are not mutually exclusive. For example, you may take something on the basis of authority. Your major professor suggested that this was the best course of action. And then you may think about the question at hand that you're interested in, and you reason, if he told me that, then maybe I should organize something this way. And then you may go test it empirically. They're not mutually exclusive. Most of us don't even realize that we're going through these various ways of knowing. Now, consider the source. We absorb information from all kinds of sources. Books, easy, blogs, technical reports, these types of exchanges, hallway conversations, And somehow, we must filter the sense from the nonsense. We must be able to identify, okay, he's telling me about an opinion there. So I need to remember that that was an opinion or that was an inference. And a good place to start in trying to filter out the value or the of the source is to consider how far removed it is from the horse's mouth, so to speak. A primary source. A primary source is something that is a report from the original author who did the work from the horse's mouth. Often these sources are peer-reviewed before they're published, so they're vetted by other experts. And in that cycle, usually vetting means trashing it and finding all the holes in it so you can go back and fix it. But it does act as a self-correcting mechanism. Another category is secondary. We're familiar with these textbooks, for example. A textbook author has taken a work from a large body of evidence, a large body of literature, put it together, and told you what other people said. You didn't read what they said, you're reading what he said they said. So it's a little, another step removed from the horse's mouth. And finally, we have trade or popular press. Our professional publications may be oriented towards more general audiences. Usually these, the sources or where that came from are not cited. Oftentimes these are not peer reviewed. It doesn't impact necessarily the quality or the veracity of it. It just is what it is. Our job in all of this, your detective work, involves evaluating the quality of the source and how far removed that statement, that fact, might be from the original work upon which someone's telling you it was based. Now, this brings us to the third evidence detector tip, and that is questioning authority. I have put up here just a small example of some phrases you may have come across in your reading. Perhaps some of you have read that there is little evidence on them. Many studies show organizations seldom do that. Well, anybody read those? Do you ever sort of think, like, how many is many? How few are few? How does the author know this? Was this like one out of a million? Was this two out of three? Or was this just, I didn't come across anything? Well, how about these? There are no studies. This issue has not been investigated. Well, just think about that. Logically and practically, this is so flawed. Logically, we cannot prove that something doesn't exist. We can only fail to find it. There is a big difference between there aren't any and we didn't find it. Now, there may not be any. But did we look at everything that had ever been written since the dawn of time? Probably not. Better put might be that the author said, I haven't found any. So, key point here, questioning authority, examine your sources. Consider where it came from. Don't accept statements on face value. Just because something is in print doesn't make it true. Our key points here in considering the evidence and evaluating how you come upon the decision is think about how you know. Did you just stick to tenacity? A little bit of authority thrown in? Is there any empirical stuff going on there? Remember, I know we're practitioners, but let's don't practice on the client. Clients are not our guinea pigs. We owe them valid and reliable solutions. Evaluate the case for yourself. If you can't defend it, don't do it. And that is the essentials of evidence-based practices. Now, we're going to turn you over to Claire to try to put some of these evidence essentials in practice. So far, any questions of what we've covered in terms of the fundamentals?
Just a group check. And this is where you give a nod, you stand your feet, you hit the person next to you. We're good. You got it.
All right. So before we get you into the little exercise, let's just make sure we're all on the same page with definitions. What is a fact? What do we mean by a fact? Anyone? This is like Ferris Bueller. Anyone? Anyone? It's true. It's true.
Well, it's verifiable.
Okay. And any other comments about what is fact?
Valid.
You say it's valid? Okay, and evidence-based. How would you explain to someone what is folklore?
None of the above.
Okay, none of the above. Or maybe all of the above, right? Okay. Let's take just to get sure we're all on the same page. Fact, as you said, valid, reliable. Right? Folklore, the opposite of that. Perhaps there was a seed of truth at one time and it has evolved and taken on its own life form. And you can think of many issues currently in the contemporary news. Well, we won't go down that path, right? Let's just stay on this particular session dealing with Mythbusters. All right, so what's going to happen? You on your net, you're going to be in your groups since you're already well organized. And on the count of three, I would like you to point to the most amazing looking individual at your table. Ready? One, two, three. Point. Who has the most points? Okay, raise your hand if you have the most points. Who at this table here? Most points. Over here, raise your hand if you have the most points. Congratulations. Now, leaders, your job will be to maintain crowd control and lead your group through the exercise. And as the leader of your table, you may be the spokesperson, or because you're the leader, you may delegate that and direct someone at your table to speak for the group, all right? So what do we have? On the next page of your handout, you have four claims. Would like your group to pick one of the claims. It's your choice, leader. You can help direct this. And you will talk among yourselves to determine, is that claim fact or folklore? If you have a talented and gifted group and you finish quickly before the time limit is up, please go on and select another claim. Are we clear on the task? Fact, folklore, nod your head. Leaders, give me a sign. Your group is ready. You can coach them. Okay, you have 6 minutes for this exercise. So please.
Plus or minus one.
There you go. Okay. Please begin. Talk among yourselves.
Everything. he's in the air because it's a blessing.
Yes,
it sounds like, but
Content.
But the 7 plus or minus 2 thing, I couldn't find it. What evidence essential do you think that this example illustrates? What went wrong here, you think?
The secondary sources. Everybody's saying Miller said it.
Well, I don't know if they actually read it or not, but I couldn't verify that that's what he said.
You might want to repeat what she said.
Oh, say it louder, because that was really good. Say it louder.
I think perhaps that people are using secondary sources, seeing that Miller is cited over and over and over again. Very clearly, 7 plus or minus 2, everybody's saying Miller's saying that, but nobody's going back to read Miller for themselves.
Another one that comes to mind is way of knowing of authority. Really credible people that I respect cited this, and so I go, okay, sure, I buy that. Until I started digging a little deeper. So the content part, I would say, I would go with that. But in terms of the claim itself, I think it's morphed rather like the telephone game. Retelling and retelling of a phrase.
Okay.
Failure to check the original source, led astray by authority.
Okay, next one, claim. Two questions on that. Claim. Okay, very good, folklore. And can you get extra bonus points?
Yeah.
All right, claim two.
Does that mean if I win, I get two? I get the license and the
receipt.
Well, we're not done yet. Yeah. We have to see if you can continue to work.
We'll let you work that out with God. All right, claim two. Things that occur together tend to be learned together. How many say fact?
Well, don't be shy.
How many say folklore? How many don't know?
At least you're honest.
Get the point of that. All right. Any comments on why you thought it was fact?
Can you give an example of what you mean?
Things that occur together tend to be learned together. Those of you who are instructional designers, give an example.
I think the question alone kind of leads it away from being a fact. A lot of ways work. I mean, you leave it kind of hanging out there and say tend to.
Okay, so you're challenging even the statement.
There's nothing
okay.
to say that they're in the statement, but you can say fact or not fact.
Okay. Any
an example, a traffic light. After it turns yellow, it'll turn red. We tend to learn that because those occur together in time, that red follows yellow. The simple example.
And this is often applied in situations of on-the-job training. People will try to what they call chunk items because they occur in a sequence and they're going to learn that particular sequence, right? So it is commonly applied in different settings. And I invite you to challenge these statements. But we had a mix of response here. Some were saying facts, some were saying folklore. Mary, the research shows. Well, it does seem, it sort of passes the reason test that if it happens together, you might learn them together. You see a flame, you stick your finger in it, and it's an alley. So you associate putting your finger in the flame with having an alley. But does it have an empirical basis? Well, I looked into that. I was kind of curious about that. And I traced it back. I could only trace it back to Aristotle at about 350. Now, I didn't read in the original language, I had to read the English translations, but he does have accounts of the associative nature of memory. Well, since then, it's accumulated quite a body of knowledge, quite a body of evidence. We have the Locke and Hume, the philosophers. Then we have the empirical testers of it, Ebbinghaus. The applied associationism is theory of learning. We have Thorndike. Anybody heard of Thorndike? Okay. The experiment sorted supports associations that are influenced by consequences. And now there were Feigl, spoiler, sort of took issue with a few of those. But he just skipped over the contemporary data that supported.
In my opinion, this is my opinion now, I would grant it fact.
Comment. Hey. Sorry, I was just going to say pathos is one of the most common ones. Yeah.
Oh, that's a good example. Ring a bell.
They use reinforcement, so you want to get a dolphin to do a flip, you're showing them how to do a flip, you blow the whistle, he knows that's a positive reinforcement, thumbs gets a tree. But they don't know exactly what they did in that moment, and in their brain they're doing as many as 11 things at a time, right? And so if they blow a fart nose out their blowhole, which is a really common thing, while they're doing the flip, you've now reinforced both. And they have to then go into a really difficult series of steps to detrain them from the second learning event. And otherwise, they will continuously have that and make that same noise every time. So that was one of the discussions we were having here from the behavioralists.
And then have a challenge in the back.
The athletic, we take a lesson from a golf coach, tennis coach, I've been recruiting volleyball coach. We break skills out and make them work on footwork and have nothing to do with anything else, but just put the feet in the same place or then switch to where the hands had to be or wherever else. And it wasn't sequential, so that eventually we could take those skills and put them back together again in a sequence. And, you know, it makes sense to sometimes chunk things together, but it also makes sense to isolate and focus just on a skill that has nothing to do with anything else, and eventually say, okay, remember this skill, put them all together. It's a wax on, wax off, paint the
thing. I think you just proved your own case, though. The reason you do that is so that they don't learn the wrong footwork while they're learning the right arm swing.
Well, that may be true, but in terms of tending to learn things together, that's taking
a true. I would agree this isn't better. I would agree this isn't saying it's better to learn together.
Well, I would agree with that.
Yeah,
well,
yeah,
better, it makes sense. But the, once again, the wax on, wax off, karate kid, he didn't know what he was learning. And then all of a sudden, he put the equipment and all of the other forms.
Other comments? And this is, yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, I sort of read the statement, and I think what we're really talking about, correct me if I'm wrong, but it's really like remapping correlation or understanding the cause and effect relationship. You know, when I read this the first time, I sort of thought, well, I don't know, if I'm, say, looking at this conference and there's a fire across the street, am I learning those two things together? But I think we're talking about cause and effect relationship, is that?
Well, we can look at things that happen together, but remember, things that happen together don't imply causation.
Right.
Like ice cream and crime, for example, you know that classic example. Well,
right.
When people buy more ice cream when the crime rate rises, or the crime rate rises when people buy more ice cream.
Ice cream causes crime.
Yeah, so therefore ice cream causes crime. So we really don't want to get into the cause and effect. And Aristotle was basing this on observations of naturally occurring events, not manipulating, not training, making an empirical observations, which was that was just redundant, and then making a conclusion that, oh wow, look, things that happen together tend to be learned together.
So what we've just witnessed in this room over the last couple minutes is you are already applying some of the items that we presented in your first page of your handout in your MythBusters tools. You were questioning how the statement was worded. You certainly questioned authority, which is us. I'm absolutely doing the challenge. And we commend you for that.
Yeah.
And you were starting to say, does this really make sense, and looking for a logical way. So you're already demonstrating.
we're hoping to achieve as a result of this session. So let's move on to claim number three. And let me again remind you of the rules of engagement in this group. There is no attacking of the presenters. And there is no physical attack with one another. All right, but we can have a loud and lively response. So the claim is the Myers-Briggs type indicator, better known perhaps as MBTI, is a reliable and valid instrument. How many say fact?
Come on,
be brave.
Don't be shy.
Okay, how many say folklore? How many don't know? How many don't care? Alright, so without further ado, let's explore why you think it's a fact or a folklore before Mary reveals the answer.
Any thoughts on the folklore? Wait, who said it was folklore? Why?
Well, I've looked at some of the repeatability and validity scores for it, and for some of the 16...
You looked something up?
Yes. and for a couple of the 16 types, even by their own data, it's very marginal.
Repeatability,
somewhere between 40% and 60%, something
right.
like that.
Anybody else see those studies? Because,
Experience.
Oh my God, it's so popular. People wouldn't be using something that was bogus. What studies have you done with it?
Now, how many use it in your workplace? For perhaps some training sessions. Leadership development.
Use it anyway.
Okay.
It has a lot of things called face validity. Right? That term is something we use in jest that means it looks really good and there's nothing much behind the curtain. Now, yes, I have seen those same data that it is not reliable. That means it's not consistent. That means if you take the test over, repeat the test, you may not get the same type indicator, type same profile. Any test that is not consistent, that is not reliable, is therefore invalid. You can't have something, you cannot have validity without reliability. So, but everybody uses it, right? So it's okay that it's suspect. It can be used for parties. I think it would make a grand party game. Or a discussion starter for those that are already using it. Nevertheless, my vote is folklore.
And you who looked it up, I think you're just an INTJ. Okay, moving on to the question. You have a question?
INTP, as the...
we're in trouble now.
You are in trouble. But I think a lot of the challenge is around what, not what the Association for Psychological Type or MBTI would claim, but rather what people claim on its behalf. So they're fairly precise that they recognize it's a really imperfect instrument. You know, so, and they are doing the best that they can to refine an instrument to track a phenomena they believe exists. So, you know, they're fairly realistic about it, but I think the way that it is used in business and other organizations is frequently scary. It's less about, is it reliable and valid in general, they say it's evolving and they're hoping.
And Don, you bring up a good point. Remember at the very beginning when Mary said, one of our obligations is to ensure that we do no harm, right? And I personally have seen where the Myers-Briggs type instrument has had flawed applications, where people have made hiring decisions on if somebody is of a particular type score on that day. I've seen worse when they have had people who have not been selected for promotion in the organization because they don't fit a particular type.
type, or that individuals were denied opportunity for a management position because they weren't the right type or what they thought they would need. So I think you bring up an excellent point. It really, in many ways, the flawed application. But again, we're looking at this from an empirical, evidence-based position. And when we want to then apply the tools that are outlined on page one of are they valid, reliable, consistent, who's saying that it is, how is it being used? Ken, you wanted to make a comment.
Well, my comment was that I didn't actually read the study, but I did read Dick Clark's summary of the study. And his point is that the problem with it is it only achieves those marginal numbers when the MBTI people do the studies. When anybody else does the studies, the reliability and predictability goes way down.
Yeah,
so it's not a there's
inter-rater reliability.
There's no inter-rater reliability. Not that there's any suggestion that he was tweaking the data, but it just seems magical that when the test developers do the test, the reliability is significantly higher than what anybody else does.
Yeah, but what the heck? Why should we believe Dick Clark? I mean, really?
Hey, who is he? He's only an authority.
Really? Okay. You have her comment, and then you.
Okay. I'm taking this darn thing 6 times. I turn out INTP every time. So doesn't that make it reliable and valid?
Yes. Well, I have the most wonderful spouse who says, well, am I supposed to take it? Am I going to turn out as a JBRK? But that's comment. You have to comment back here.
My comment about that, or the answer to that question, is that any one of the personality tests that are given, period, I mean, it's all self-reporting. You skew the answers. You skew the test the way you want to be perceived when you take it to the beginning. Even if it's at a subconscious level, we're all familiar enough with what's out there. So even if you haven't taken it, you realize you're taking a personality test. It's going to place you into a box. Well, you pre-decide which box you want to go into, and then you use your intelligence to skew the answers on the test to fit you into that box. So it's not really a true assessment, it's just how do you view yourself. I mean, it's no one in mirrors. It's not really, if I'm a manager, I can manipulate the test the way I want to.
Okay, and for the sake of time, we can continue this at the bar this evening for this conversation, but you brought up the point of intelligence, which leads us to the next claim.
Nice segue. Are you a DJ? What is that? Yeah.
Your screen's on the way.
No,
she's not.
Most people use only about 10% of their brains. Right? How many say fact? How many say folklore? Okay, and Mary?
Well, how many have heard variations of this? Ever heard about this? Like, we only use 10% of our brains, but we can remember 30% of what we read, and 25% of what we learn is all trash? Well, geez, you know, must be true. We see it everywhere. Now, there was a couple of researchers who I guess had nothing better to do than to look at how many versions of this they could find and how many different kinds of sources. And then they wanted to see how many psychology majors, which was a suspect to begin with, believed this claim. Well, poor psychology majors. But there were hundreds of variations of this across all kinds of sources, all kinds of language.
Wow.
And the psychology majors, unfortunately, pretty much said they believed it. So we won't go that way anymore. However, there is absolutely no empirical evidence to support it.
Absolutely none?
Yeah.
Now, if you would like more
He's got a little bag of tricks there over his shoulder, things that he's learned to do. And it's a sunny, bright, beautiful day, and he has some solutions in mind for his clients. And where is he about to go?
Over a cliff.
Over a cliff. So he may have heard from authority, it might be some kind of tradition, something that's been around for a long, long time. But he may not be looking where he's going. So one of our main points of this whole session is let us look before we leap. In other words, before we subject perfectly good people to our solutions, our interventions, our way of doing things, how about if we take a look at what we're doing beforehand to see what's our evidence for that and how might we defend it and why do I think that this thing that I am about to do might work? So, we came up with a little matrix. It's on the last page of your handout. It has, across the top, it has ways of drawing from Peirce. It looks like Pierce, but he pronounced it Peirce, apparently. So these are the things that Mary has already talked to you about. And then down the left-hand side, we have another way of looking at how do I know this will work? And this is from a presentation I did at ISBI back in 2001, and it has since been incorporated into a couple of things where we were looking at Guy's behest at, you know, what do we accept as human performance technology anyway, and what would we accept as evidence that it in fact works? And we adopted this little framework over here on the left-hand side. So we're going to put things in four different buckets. Now, things don't always fit happily in a bucket. Sometimes they slop over. Sometimes they want to be in two different buckets at the same time. But just for the sake of having something that we can talk about, we're going to put things into these little buckets. So folklore, or, you know, the thing that I'm the most concerned about here is snake oil, is the first one on the top of the left side there. Now, this might be traditional beliefs, or it might be something like one of the things that Mary has just talked with you about, whether it fits or doesn't fit, whether it's fact or folklore. So let's just take something. If you implement folklore or snake oil in an organization, snake oil being something that we could look up and find out that this really, there's not evidence to support this. In fact, perhaps there's evidence to support that what we're about to do is a bad idea. Does this ever happen in organizations? Okay, so there's zillions of them out there implementing the MBTI, for example. And as Clara was talking about, sometimes it's used for hiring decisions. This is a real problem because it really doesn't have predictive validity. You can't use it to predict how well a person would be a manager or something. There are many other things that could be snake oil that we might want to implement because maybe someone told us to, maybe because, you know, there was an authority telling us that we should do it. When we get over to the left here, folklore or snake oil, you're not going to find an empirical or scientific basis to back it up. There's a null set over there. I think it's a double null set because we know that that is not going to be reliable. It's not going to be valid. Now, if we're looking at intuition or exploration, what do we think about intuition or exploration? Is this a good thing?
No.
Yeah. Okay. I can even have a hunch that something might work. We tried something in this organization, and it went really well with this population. And because of kind of what I know about these people, what I know about what we just did, I think it's going to work over here in this context. But I have a hunch, okay? And if I'm honest, I'm looking at what is behind my decision to implement this over here. It's not that I have scientific evidence that says that this thing works in all contexts. No. It's that it worked over here, and I think it will work over here, so I'm going to try it out. And I think that there's low risk that I'm going to hurt anybody, cause any really bad situation to happen. I have a hunch. Hypotheses are kind of like, you know, overgrown and well-documented hunches.
There's lots of things that we might do because of our intuition. Also, people who are experts, really have a lot of composed expertise in a field, will have what they call intuition or hunches, and it's ideas or conclusions that they come to based on knowledge that they have that's so composed and resides in them so well that they can't even remember what they know about it. You know that expression, she's forgotten more than he knows about, let's say, research? So that's what happens when people become super experts, is they forget what they know. And then they have something, they go, I have a hunch, I have an idea. So the more expert they are in the field in which they have a hunch or an idea, the more likely it is that it might be a good thing. Okay, but what I'm just advocating is, let's acknowledge that it's a hunch. All right? Next one is respected practice. Respected practice means we're not sure we know why this works, but it's been done over and over and over again in multiple situations, either in this organization or across organizations. And as far as we know, there's no scientific evidence yet to tell us why this works, when it works, how it works. But you know what? It seems to work repeatedly. Tiagi does it, and every time he does it, it works. Harold Stalovich does it, and every time he does it, it works. It works for Guy. It works for Ken. All right? And so I say, I'm going to try this. And I'm telling myself, it's not that I have a hunch. It's not that it's really not snake oil, because it works, and we respect the practice that we're about to follow. All right? And then the last one is evidence-based. There is some evidence underneath what it is that we're doing. So, an example of that might be giving feedback. There's some evidence that suggests that giving corrective feedback, like, hey, you really screwed up, in public is bad for people. So we want to give corrective feedback in private. And so we implement that in our culture, in our organization, and there's evidence behind it. Does that make sense? Okay, so that's the kind of looking at things that work. And by things, I mean solutions or interventions, the stuff that we do in organizations. And I just want everybody, before they implement a thing or make a strong recommendation to go in this direction, to think through, okay, what's behind my recommendation? So we were looking at these. We had many conversations among the three of us. And we were looking at Peirce's ways of knowing, which are very cool. You know, have we always done it this way? Did Dick Clark tell me to do it this way? Did I just figure it out? If this, then that? Or is there science behind it? And then we looked at, okay, well, if I'm looking at what's my rationale for going ahead with something, whether it's folklore, intuition, respected practice, or evidence-based, what if we put these two things together, what would happen? And the purpose of doing this is because we want things that we implement in organizations to be defensible. We want to have a reason for saying, this is where we're going. All right, now, the only one of these things is bad. Now, folklore is not so bad. We've always done it this way, like let's say next year we have drumming at the opening event, and the following year we have drumming at the opening event, because we just find that everybody loves it and it becomes a tradition and we just go ahead and do it. All right, great. If it's snake oil, though, if we make you all sign up for the MBTI and we make you wear the initials on your badge so that we know how to treat you when we meet you everywhere, and I can see that, you know, Ken is an introvert, so I have to really work hard to talk to him, you know, things like that. We don't want to do that to people because it pigeonholes them, and you can actually... I've seen the MBI used in ways that it can be good, and I've also seen it used in ways that really cause pigeonholing. So instead of having one kind of prejudice against a person, I now have a new prejudice. I now have a new box that I can put them in. I have seen in one high-tech company, it shall remain nameless, I walked into this guy's office and he had a tent card on top of his computer monitor with his initials on the top of it. So that when I walked into his office, I would be able to immediately pigeonhole him as this kind of a person. And now I can treat him this way. And you know what the data show from social psychology? If you do that, if you give somebody some kind of a test, and you tell them it has some kind of scientific basis or validity, and then you, I could pass out personality types to you folks here randomly. And then, you know, and we could all put them on our badge. You know what would start happening? We would each start treating each other as if we had those personality types. And then it becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy because I start acting like you're treating me, and then you keep treating me even more like I'm now acting, and it just becomes something that becomes ingrained. Now, is that doing no harm? I don't think so. But they've done studies and studies and studies of this and found that, in fact, if you tell people that they are a kumquat, they will begin to behave like a kumquat, and people will begin to treat them like a kumquat, and, you know, really, do we need that? It's hard enough to be yourself and go through life without extraneous fruits being applied. Okay, so we have a legend for the Matrix. And the stars here, these are things that we think you can defend. If what you're wanting to do falls into a category where there's a star, we think you can probably defend it pretty well. If there's a question mark, we're not at all sure that it's defendable. It might be, in fact, questionable. And if there's a big goose egg there, it's either refutable or not even particularly possible for those two things to go together. Like, we don't have snake, well, we can have snake oil and empirical in terms of the empirical basis showing us that it's probably snake oil. But we're not going to have very good empirical evidence that shows that snake oil is in fact true. Make sense? All right. So now, what I want you to do is jot down on your handout or somewhere one or two or three interventions or solutions that you're currently thinking about implementing in your organization, or you've implemented recently, or you'd love to implement. Just write down a few of it. One, two, or three. I'm just going to give you a minute. Okay, you got it? Okay, how many have found a place for at least one item on the matrix? Anybody find a place? Find places? Okay, how many found places that have started? Okay, very good. And let's get some examples. Who has an example of a solution? Go ahead.
So I'm in sales training.
Yes.
We recently implemented an alternate reality being teaching closing skills. And the reason that we did this was an intuition and exploration we wanted to try it out. And it was based on reason and logic. It makes sense that people should be able to practice the skills, get instant feedback, self-study on the materials that we provided, and then practice again with more feedback. And it was a consistent loop. And it worked.
And it worked. All right. Yay! That's really good. Did you have any trouble defending it when you were proposing it?
Yes.
What do you think, what, was it because it was intuition and logic together?
I think it was just because it was a crazy idea and it was so different than any training we've ever done.
Okay. But that's a great example of what we're talking about. Okay, who else has an example?
Well, what we're doing is a 360 degree feedback, which I think is under respected practice. I don't even know if I'm saying the right thing because I'm not an PT, but
okay.
The difference on intuition and exploration, and it's, I just saw a book, and it's about giving when you have a relationship with difficulties in the work class because I see two people that are just conflicting. And we're going to try out the 100/0. We get 100% and expect nothing back, and hopefully the relationship will change. I don't know if this is the right move forward. It sounds more like we're just probably going to start something much more basic about that.
Oh, okay, so you might give us some thought to what you were planning to do based on looking at it this way?
Yeah.
Okay,
I think it's great. Risky.
Okay, it might be risky. Now, as far as the 360 stuff goes, this is one of those things that's really popular to do in organizations. And there are some data that suggest that, depending, of course, on how you do it, that it can be problematic. So one of the things that, let's see, why do people do it? I think it's becoming kind of traditional to do 360s. People say, 360 evaluation, this is something that sophisticated organizations have. So I think we should do it. All right, and so we add a little authority to that because it's the director of HR who's telling us to do it. And, you know, reason and logic, hey, if you get feedback, that's good, right? And if you get feedback from different people in the organization, that's going to be even better. 360 degrees better. All right, so that makes all kinds of sense. What I would do before I did that is I would really want to look at the evidence. What does the empirical evidence show us about 360? Because some of the things that I've read, and I have not personally looked into this deeply, that it's all self-report. Okay, so self-report data is always flawed. It's self-report or it's other report. You know, so they ask me, you know, how organized is Hillary? And I think, well, I like Hillary. She seems like a good person. I bet she's organized. I'm organized, and so I think she's organized too, because she's like me, because I like her. And so people make stuff up when they fill out those forms, and sometimes they lie. Like if I didn't like Scott here, and I wanted the promotion instead of him, and I thought somebody was going to see the results of this 360, I might say that he's not an organized person. Alright? Besides that, he talks about me behind my back. So I might put that on the form too. So what I'm saying is, before I implemented something like that, which, oh by the way, I have seen grown adults in high leadership positions dissolve into tears at offsites based on data that they got from their 360.
Well, we should put them through Meyer, for instance.
Exactly. And then we can figure out why.
But he can only get on 7 things.
Okay, very good, very good. So plus or minus. And plus, if they would just use more than 10% of their brain.
Yes.
Yeah.
Actually, a
question for you. I noticed that both of you talked about trying something out. And you talked about trying, you know, particular intervention, we're willing to try it out. And so I think that there's this sort of this theme of trial in our field, and we think that sometimes we may sort of relax the levels of, or the ways of knowing, sort of accept perhaps, we call them lower levels, but.
That's a good point.
And what do you think the issues are with that?
Is everybody hearing that? That we often accept a high level of trial and error in what we're doing in our organizations and with our people. It's like, well, I think this will work. Let's subject so many guinea pigs in the organization to this. And is that okay? Is that what you're asking? Is that something we should really examine?
Do you think that we relax the levels? Will we accept maybe a lower level of evidence for something if we're willing to try it out? And what are some of the having that mentality?
Oh, that's a really good question. So will we sometimes accept a lower level of evidence for things that we want to try out because we just think it's a good idea? What do you think the answer to this question is?
Yeah.
My hunch is yes, we absolutely do that. Go ahead, Ken.
Yeah, I was going to ask a sort of related question.
Okay, anything more about relaxing? Okay, well, here's something that I think we're trying to say is please go look stuff up. Go see if you can find evidence. And remember, Mary was talking about primary and secondary sources. What kind of source are you looking in? And we're not saying you have to go to all primary sources and read all the original research. Sometimes the most helpful thing you can do is go find a meta-analysis of something. Go find a meta-analysis. Myers-Briggs. We've looked at hundreds of studies about the Myers-Briggs and how well it works and doesn't work, and examines point by point by point where it has efficacy, where it does not have efficacy, where it works, where it doesn't work, where it does what it says it will do, where it doesn't do what it will say it will do. And so there are many studies out there, and many of us maybe sometimes get lazy because of tradition, because we think we have a great idea, and we just go ahead and do something without trying to go to the source, because you know that's a lot of work. But now that we have Google, it's less work. Or even if you have the right people in your network, if you have Twitter, it can be a lot less work. I was looking for a source the other day, and I typed a question and said, does anybody know where I can find something about X? And I put the right hashtag in where I know little nerdy people about learning hang out, and I got two or three answers of, here's a great bibliography, go there. So, you know, then I could go easily find something.
It's also about the client relationship, right? It's also about the client relationship.
Yes.
That you're providing the solution to. And I think the point of integrity is saying, here's what we know about it. Mm-hmm. And allowing them to assume the risk, not you putting them in the risky position. If I have a client who's dead set on using Myers-Briggs, and I'd rather I facilitate it as a skeptic. Right, and put that out there in the facilitation and make sure it's being used properly than to have him bring some Yahoo in from outside.
Who totally is a true believer.
And is going to tell him to use it in ways that are inappropriate, right? But that's the discussion I have in the pre-meeting. That's not the discussion I have during the facilitation.
Well, that's a good point, too. Right. But can you facilitate it without doing harm? Can you anesthetize the people? Or anesthetize? That's not the right word. Inoculate.
I like that, too.
Inoculate the folks ahead of time so that they maybe don't go down that, you know, let's have their prejudice road.
Uh-huh. I want to go back to the question that you asked,
Julia,
earlier about selling that notion.
Mm-hmm.
My experience, and maybe it's just that I'm not good at sales, is that it's much easier to sell the goose eggs and the question marks to clients than it is to sell the stars, because the people you're selling to believe all these folklores and myths and snake oil. And when you go, well, actually, there really is some research on how the eye moves on a page and where the graphic ought to go, and no, flying bullets on slides are really not good. They detract from learning. And they go, no, they don't. They're really cool, and our people love them, and so they're going to do it anyway.
How do we deal with that?
Is that your experience as well? And
I run into people all the time who are not deterred by evidence.
Okay, thank you. That says it.
But I think as an internal person, we often don't have the luxury of those in senior leadership positions of even having them consider evidence. Case in point, senior decision makers in my organization several years ago, made a decision that the new buildings will all be open space architecture. So we're going from traditional private offices, cubicles, the traditional office place, to new facilities, totally open. No walls, no private offices, people having face-to-face on their work centers, right? Why? Any evidence, any research that showed this really improved collaboration? That's what they were being sold, that this improves cross-collaboration and communication. What do you think the real reason is? It's cheaper, absolutely. So here is an imposed decision that's going to have major impact on the entire culture and structure and interaction of our workforce. It's not based on evidence, not based on any kind of real theory of thinking through how workplace environments, you know, have improved productivity, but based on dollars. And that's the harsh reality we have to face as practitioners of that. Now we have to deal with that constraint.
I would also say it's not based on results, right? So it's only focused on the cost issue. As soon as it is focused on the other issue, absolutely has to be focused on the results of the first thing.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. And there is, okay, we can take like, okay, you and you and you. That's what we're going to do.
The other side of it that is sometimes frustrating, like if you look at my shop,
evaluation. So you're going to have a hard time getting things that are truly innovative. Like Barney Duncan says, we really need to stop tinkering around the education patient to innovate and make things work. So there seems to be this sort of constant tension between if it isn't really empirically validated and in a big R research for a very long time, no, we're not going to fund it, but on the other hand, what it takes to be able to fund that and drive it. If you're a small organization, you're probably not going to have access to that level of funding to help you make it. So it's sort of frustrating to check with it, both sides.
Okay, so does looking stuff up have to cost a lot of money?
If you're
time is money.
Standards, it's more than looking it up.
Yeah, and if you're going to do, sometimes there's been research done already and enough of it that you could make a pretty good case. And I was going to say that one of the things that's going on that I just think is fascinating, and I would love to have data on this. You know, somebody mentioned CSI earlier, and when that show first came out, there was just one of them. And they constantly, every single episode said, I realize you think he's guilty, but what's your evidence? And they do that over and over and over again. For a while there, it was the most popular show on TV, and now it has offshoots that are also really popular. And it seems to me that whether they know it or not, what these people are doing, and I don't know if they have this in mind, is planting this seed in the American consciousness that evidence matters. Can we sort of prove it? Not that we get in social psychology, which is the area we're in, when you're trying to prove that people function better if you do this versus that. We have so many variables, it's really tough to do. But there is a lot of evidence out there that isn't maybe being used. It's languishing on dusty shelves in libraries and not always being used. But there certainly are people in the world who make a living or a habit of looking up those kinds of things, and those people are kind of accessible. Some of them are here in this building, wandering around giving presentations. So it is possible to find people who know stuff. Okay, you.
My question is actually kind of related to her, but I'm hearing a lot of don't do something unless it's evidence-based, unless it gets a scar or something like that, unless you're sure it's going to be okay. But my question is, how do you get the evidence? How does the world get the evidence that it's going to be okay, unless somebody has it?
Well, what we're really saying is we want you to be conscious of where you are here.
Look before you leave.
Am I doing this because intuitively it seems okay? That's an okay thing to do if you can do it in your organization. We're not saying that's a bad idea. We're saying don't implement snake oil, but we are saying it's okay if it's your intuition, but don't treat your intuition like it's truth. It's okay if it's respected practice. Acknowledge that it's respected practice. If you have solid evidence underneath what you're doing, acknowledge that. And it is easier to justify things that have solid evidence.
I guess part of it is kind of how does something get to be respected practice? I guess you do it, but then you report it to others. And ISBI.
You might evaluate the results of the thing. You know, did performance improve? Did we save time? Did we save money? Is there better quality? You know, what happened as a result? And then you report it, and then someone else can read your report, and they can say, "Well, I think that would happen. Might work here. Intuition." Now they do it, and they evaluate, and maybe they make a report. Now we have two reports. So over time. Or, you know, you just say, well, Tiaki doesn't. Oh, wait, he's a special case. He can get away with anything. God Wallace does it. So therefore, there must be something underneath the decision that was really good. I respect his practice. Okay? Yes, ma'am. I know. All right. The very next slide, which I guess I'm going to have to do myself here. These were the objectives we had at the beginning. We wanted to give you some criteria for assessing your performance improvement strategies, which I think we've done. We wanted to look at practices in the workplace and see how did they measure up. We applied a framework to your own things. Everybody has a chance to look at your own things and apply this framework, and you're very welcome to use it over and over again if it is helpful to you. And you even may look a little closer at something. How many, did anybody else come up with something they said maybe I need to look a little closer? Other people? Yeah, we do have some. Okay. And now, what we hope that you will do is go ahead and use that method of, okay, here's what I'm thinking of doing. Where does it fit on this matrix? Maybe I can apply this in my work environment. Maybe the next time I'm at work and I have an idea, I can apply it to the matrix. And voila. So, our obligation as performance improvement consultants, or whatever you're calling yourself right now, since we have different names and different roles, we have an obligation to this RSVP, to be, okay, stay with me, results-focused, take a systems view, add
value,
promote
partnerships,
plus we want to remain solution-neutral. All right, especially we want to go for it into no harm. All right, thank you so much for coming.